much enough to hit the ladder skate. Tell me when discretion gonna be my fate. Gonna be a fate, gonna be a fate. Peace to the world, let it rotate. Sex, money, murder, I DNA.
Suzuki no be jinjang, Jeteri no be lukenga. You know me, I'm the Sankofa facilitator training. And so we all were in the first session, so. No, you don't have to have been in the first session. No, no, no. I was just assuming that most of us were, and I don't have to spend very much time on the slide explaining what Sankofa is. But the Sankofa circle. You were in the circle. Right. I think everybody in the room was here.
No, she wasn't.
Oh, no, no. Okay, so she just got here. Okay. Okay. No, I'm okay.
Oh, you're good?
Yeah, things have been working. Unless it, I haven't done anything as of yet to know if I'm having a problem.
The other gentleman said that he was having trouble getting inside the room.
Okay. Yeah, we've been okay so far.
Okay,
yeah. Mm-hmm. You want to do it? Okay. This is my sister right here.
So thank you for coming to this session. And I think we'll preface, and I think you read the description, that, you know, part of the work of cooperatives is creating community and creating safe spaces. And I was just telling the sister that, you know, the return of the benefit is really something that we call social capital, and we'll talk about it, right? But it's really relationships, it's a shared sense of investment. It's this ability to believe that you can trust and depend on the people that you're working with, right? It's having a shared goal, right, that we're all in this because we want something better. We want to create something better. We want to serve the community. And being able to do that is a process. So oftentimes we talk about cooperative business development, and we develop kind of the knowledge of how a cooperative business operates. You need bylaws, you know, you need to get incorporated, you need 5 people, you know, all these things, right? But we don't really talk about how do you build the identity of cooperation that supports the business. And so this work that we've been doing around the Sankofa circle model is one, it answers what Dr. Jessica Nimhart-Garden talked about, is culturally relevant practices, right? And so it's us, as we were building cooperatives, we realized, like she said in her book, right, the educational materials do not connect, right? And you probably would be like, this is the best thing since sliced bread. Why can't I get any black people to work on this? And what I realized is that I was using tools that were not culturally connecting, right? And to be able to really bring people of African descent into cooperation, I needed to use tools that connected culturally. So I'll just say this, when I was in graduate school, I used to think I had like this reading disorder, right? I'd be like, well, I'm reading this, and then I got to read it over again and then read it over again. And then we learned in graduate school that like language was culturally coded. And I was like, oh my God. And then what happened was I was in the English department with a lot of black students, and the brother wrote his paper about P-Funk. And all the white students was like, I just had no idea what you were talking about, right? And I was like, no, but he, and I realized like, oh my God, like really in the writing, how we write and how we talk, there's cultural codes that either bring us in or keep us out, right? And so part of what we practice and we focus on is the cultural tools for people of African descent for building black cooperation. And the Sankofa Circle is a part of that. And so as we said, we've been doing this for the last 20 years, and we started practicing the circle in college when we were at Penn State and found ourselves in very hostile environments, racial terrorism, literally where people were killing people and threatening to kill us as black students who were vocalizing around the conditions in which we found ourselves. And we used the circle, and the circle really came about not because of the racial terrorism, but because of the violence that was being enacted, the internalized racism among black students on campus, right? And we knew we needed to deal with it, right? And so we began to have these circles every single week talking about all the issues that we were dealing with as students and beginning to dialogue on that. and using this identity or this premise of the Sankofa, the Dinka symbol of saying that we need to base ourselves in history and in a social analysis to be able to understand our role and our responsibilities in the present, right? That what we were doing and what we were acting out had been kind of laid a pathway to us from this historical trajectory that we found ourselves in. So the Sankofa is part of the social analysis, right? It's how do you critique the existing systems, what's working, what's not working, and it's how you can make an accurate social analysis, because if you don't make an accurate social analysis, then you won't get to an accurate, appropriate solution, right? And that's why we find ourselves using individualized strategies, because we haven't had a proper social analysis to understand that many of the things we face, you know, aren't just on the individual level, they're on the community level, and they didn't just start, they're based in, we heard the powerful video today of how the whole economic system was based in the use of our black bodies as commodities in an economic system, right? If you can't get that deep and get that analysis, then you can't figure out what to do that's gonna be appropriate. And then finally, the goal of saying, what is the responsibility, right? Because that's why we do cooperatives, because they offer us a tool and a resources to change the material, social, and cultural conditions in our communities. And so that's what this model is based in. And so it has a lot of meaning. If anybody's seen the Sankofa movie, it's very meaningful to us. It represents our ancestors and their contributions and their history and their legacy to us. And so we do move from this from a very spiritual perspective for us and a very historically perspective for us in the model.
Okay. So, you know, one piece of this, which, you know, many of us experienced and witnessed this morning when we had the Sankofa Circle, right, is that as we do a historical analysis, right, about what happened to us and what has continued to happen to us, right, and what may happen tomorrow and the next day to us, right, to our black bodies, is that all of that is stored in our bodies. It's stored in our bodies, it's stored in our body memories, it's stored in our minds, right? And that when we get into this space, it's not just about doing the analysis about what's happened, it's about giving ourselves the space to be vulnerable with one another, to allow these things to come up out of ourselves, right? For us to be able to talk about and tell our own stories, right? Because we do recognize that black people are not a monolith, right? We've had a lot of different experiences. We've had a lot of different kinds of challenges. But inside of this space, we want to be able to recognize what some of those commonalities are, right? Because that's what's going to move us towards the cooperation that we're talking about, right? And so we believe that change comes through individual and collective transformation, right? And so we will choose a topic. So if you have a Sankofa circle, you can choose a topic. When we were in college, we would do, we had all kinds, we had a Pan-African conversation, which gets testy. You know what I'm saying? Because people are coming from these different experiences. And a part of what's happening in this space is that, right, we've all been indoctrinated to see ourselves through the lens of white people and white supremacy, right? And so when we look at each other, we're judging ourselves and each other based upon a measurement that ain't even our own, right? And so we have to be present to the fact that we've been victims, like we've all been victimized, and we all have been holding these things, right? And sometimes it's very difficult for us to be vulnerable enough to say that this is what's inside of me, right? Because, you know, folks, you know, black folks, we've been matriculating through schools and colleges, and we got PhDs now, right? And who are we to say with a PhD that I've got internalized racism, right? And so, but we do. And so we'll choose different session topics, right? So we can talk about the prison industrial complex, right? And so we could get into a circle, right? And our first self question could be, how many people in this space know somebody or themselves have been locked up, right? Been arrested or locked up, right? And we see in the circle how many people raise their hands. But you might have somebody in the circle, a black person, who has not been personally affected by incarceration. It's still commonplace, right? Not as commonplace, but there's still black people who don't have a personal relationship with that, right? And so being in a space where whatever the topic is, giving ourselves the opportunity to look at how a topic that we know is impacting black people, but the nuance of how it may impact us on a personal level, right? And so we're looking at the relationship of a particular topic to the social, the political, the spiritual, the economic, and the psychological condition of ourselves, right? And so the point is that we want to develop a sense of connection to African people. I've talked about this today, right? Growing up, there was shame to be African. There was shame to be black, right? Like, we deal with all types of colorism across the world, right? And we need to be able to be in a space to unpack those things and to talk about those things. And some folks have been doing it, and there's some folks who haven't started yet, right? And so the Sankofa Circle allows us to be in a space where the spectrum of experiences of black people, that we have a space that holds folks who've been having these conversations for 20 years, as well as the folks who are just entering into their consciousness about what's going on, right? We want to develop a common concern for the well-being of black people, our whole community. And as Asada talked about, being able to analyze the root condition, right? How did we get here? I remember the sister yesterday in the first cannabis session, she talked about equity. And she said, right, like, equity is like giving people all of the different things that they need because they're at these different places. But she said it's also acknowledging the fact that, right, if somebody needs a special bike because their legs are broken, it's also acknowledging the fact that they didn't break their own legs, right? It's acknowledging that the conditions we deal with are not ones we created, right? And so we have to put the shame and the blame in the place in which it is, right? When we look at our kids fighting each other, that is an effect of an internalized violence, right? And they haven't had the analysis to understand where the enemy is, because it's not us, but because there's an anti-black propaganda that we experience through media and everywhere, right? Our children have internalized that it's us. And so we fight each other, right? And so we have to have the space then to heal from the terrorism, right?
And I want to say, we don't say this in a slide, but this has all been substantiated by research, right? Because we were college students. And so we saw the research that when you were more connected to cultural ideas and history, those students did better in college, right? We read those studies, right? We were like, oh, okay. So when you identify as yourself and your cultural roots, those students did better. Afrocentricity had an impact. There's evidence by that, right? So again, we were in college creating this model, and because we were learning all these things and we wanted to be able to put it in the work we were doing. Mm-hmm. So I just want to say there's research behind each of those pieces.
Right. Right, right. And that this circle, right, as you do this consistently, right, it serves multiple purposes. We used to have spaces where it would be so emotional and so, like, spiritually moving, right? At the end, when we would ask folks how they felt leaving this space, a lot of folks would be like, I felt like I just went to church. You know what I mean? Like, they were moved in their soul, right? And so I think that is it, one is that it speaks to the power of when we come together, right? Because one of the things I do remember from the Bible, right, what they talk about Jesus, but it don't even have to be Jesus, right? But it's really about the power in the Spirit, right? When two and three are gathered, right, with intention in our spirits, right, magic happens, right? When we were at Penn State, listen, there got to a point where we were doing now more than ever prayers and chants, and I was like, I don't respect the authority of any of these institutions. You know what I mean? Like, my whole life was like, oh, snap. Like, I'm standing on the authority of God, right? And so, yeah, like, my whole life, y'all, my whole life. So, you know, the circle is, it's a think tank. It's an educational tool, right? The information we're not getting in our classrooms, right? We're able to talk about post-traumatic slave syndrome, right? Folks who got PhDs have been doing this work, right? We can bring that information into this space and make it digestible and relevant, right? And then we can mobilize people, right? Folks can develop a consensus about what the root is and then be able to move out when the shit hits the fan, right? And that's what we were able to do. When we came back from Penn State and I went and came back to Pittsburgh, right, and a lot of folks who participated in our Sankofa circles moved back to Pittsburgh, we felt strong, like we're going to be doing this work for the rest of our lives. And many of us are, right? But when we came back to Pittsburgh, we were, and I don't know, I think, Free, this might have been when I met you, but there were, you know, some incidences of violence in our community, right, where police were killing folks. But I remember feeling so powerful. I felt like invincible, just on spirit with the community that we had developed, that we was running up in police stations and telling these white folks, like, you ain't gonna be doing this, you know what I mean? But this level of power, right?
Agency.
Right, and agency. And that part, right, it's that part of, like, recognizing that, you know, and we know this, right, but every rule, every policy, and every law, right, is not morally correct, right? Like, black people were enslaved, and there was a law, and there were laws to support all of this oppression, right? But we know that it's not morally correct, right? And so then, of course, the circle is a healing form, right, for us to allow the emotion of what we've experienced, right, and what our ancestors have experienced throughout the diaspora. Right, so the circle is about the power of spirit, culture, and the people, right? And so when we come into this space, right, it's setting the tone, right? And so using our cultural tools, right? So I grew up in a Christian family. You know, my father is a minister, my grandfather was a minister, missionaries, all of that, right? And I think that, you know, and it's no shade to the religion of Christianity. If that's your root and that's your foundation, that's all fine and good, right? But you also have to decolonize the institution of that religion, right? Because that religion was used in such a way, right, that the symbols and the language still represent oppression, still represent anti-blackness, right? And that we have to be very clear about that, and that when we're trying to galvanize and bring black people together who've been harmed in a lot of those spaces, right? And just recognize that again, like, black people are coming from all walks of life, right? So what kind of language can we speak that is inclusive to all black people, whether you're Christian, whether you're Muslim, right, whether you're a Buddhist, whatever you are, right? But we want to find the commonalities and what cultural tools can we bring into this space, right? So sometimes we might do a libation. We've been doing in some of our Sankofas over Zoom recently in Pittsburgh. We, Sister Sheba, in our Sankofa circles, will do more of a, she's a yoga practitioner, and so she'll do a sort of embodied sort of meditation where she's speaking about the ways in which we've held trauma, right? And that as we engage in a conversation that that might bring some of these painful things up, right, giving us tools, right, but also in that language, acknowledging the fact that our ancestors are here with us, right? And so there's different ways that we can acknowledge all of these things without it being limited. So, you know, of course there is, right? Because, but we've had some success, definitely. We've definitely been able to do amazing things online, right? And I think it's because, you know, folks recognize that this is where it's going to happen. Like, we're, you know, we have, like, this is our first in-person gathering in a long time, right? So we've been able to do it, right? But, of course, face-to-face, right, just with any kind of technology and the advancements of technology that claim to bring us closer together, but we know social media is actually bringing us further apart, right? Because there's nothing that can replace in-person relationship building. There's nothing that can replace holding hands. Yeah. Yeah, because, you know, it's really important for us to be able to look in each other's eyes, right? And sometimes on Zoom, you know, people want to turn their cameras off and all of that. And so, you know, a part of this work is acknowledging, right, that we've all been impacted by post-traumatic slave syndrome. So I want to play this video. Have you been in contact with any information from Dr. Joy DeGry, formerly Dr. Joy Leary? Yes? Okay, so she's somebody who has done a lot of extensive research on the impacts of the traumas. And she has, I believe she has a book called Post-Traumatic Slave Syndrome, but there's 1,000 videos on YouTube about her work and her speaking, so we're going to do one of them.
There's a kind of a fundamental basis for post-traumatic slave syndrome. How many of you are familiar with post-traumatic stress disorder? When we start talking about chattel slavery, we're not talking about one trauma. We're not talking about a specific event. We're talking about generations of trauma with no intervention. Based on what I know about sugar plantations, tobacco, and the Caribbean, what I know about American chattel slavery and the plantations there, does anyone right now ever recall mental health assistance to slaves? Anybody remember sending in the therapist after I sold off your son, daughter, raped folks? At any point? Never. Second question. After slavery was officially over, now you're free. Anybody remember any therapy then? We know it's been rough, it's been deep for you, it's been difficult, we're going to do a little group therapy. Anybody remember that? That would be no. Number three, after slavery officially ended, both in the States, in the Caribbean, the British ended, do you remember whether or not trauma continued? Did the trauma continue for people of African descent? I need to know. Okay, so now let's do the math. Hundreds of years of trauma, no treatment. Freed, more trauma, no treatment. What do you do the math? Do you think there may be residual impacts of that trauma? Of course there is. It didn't end, friends, and it hasn't ended yet. So I think on one point, African people and people of African descent are extremely resilient. Matter of fact, I think we're a miracle. Far be it for us to pathologize or to look and cast this idea of weak and sick people. Oh, on the contrary, we are profoundly resilient because we've done everything we've done thus far with no help, with not even the ability to have this discussion. As though it were possible, we escaped injury in all those hundreds of years and the years that followed. So this kind of journey I'm going to take you on is going to be one that really gives a perspective on what this trauma was, what it looks like, and clinically, what is post-traumatic stress disorder? What does it look like? Let me give you a little snapshot. We'll get into it in more depth a little later. But post-traumatic stress disorder, if in fact you are diagnosed with that, again, remember, direct or indirect trauma, here are some of the symptoms. A feeling of foreshortened future. Now, what does that mean? Well, you're not going to live long. How many of you are running into young people that don't believe they're going to make it past their 20s? Feeling of foreshortened future. Exaggerated startle response. Outbursts of anger. Difficulty falling or staying asleep. Hypervigilance. Right? These are symptoms of post-traumatic stress disorder. This is like DSM stuff, Diagnostic Statistical Manual Mental Disorders. It's in there. And there's a whole listing of all these symptoms. Now, I want to roll it back so you can understand what the transmission theory is, because I'm going to talk about transmission. So how does a person that's been traumatized by post-traumatic, literally has a diagnosis of post-traumatic stress disorder, and can we, if we are logical and we are reasonable people, assume that a fair number of Africans had to have had post-traumatic stress disorder? You think? I'm not talking about us, I'm talking about them. Untreated, though, right? Okay, so now let's do the math. Mom, who saw dad sold or sister raped, has post-traumatic stress disorder. Still mom, though, right? Only mom now has outbursts of anger, feeling of foreshortened future, difficulty falling or staying asleep, hypervigilance. That would be mom. Now, Johnny or Mary or Shaquisha did not have the original trauma. But what are they learning? This is called social learning theory. What am I normalizing? Exaggerated startle response, outbursts of anger. Are you following me? So I didn't have to be traumatized. Now, the other thing is, do you think Johnny and Mary got traumatized too? Do you see? So what happens in your environment, you learn from the significant others in your environment. And if they're broken, guess what you're going to be? You're learning from broken people. And you're normalizing that behavior. And then it becomes, years later, 2008, that's their culture.
A similar version of Going to Win on
double consciousness that we hold, right? And even when we were having the conversation about our family from the Caribbean, right, that I think that for what I've heard from some of them, right, is that they almost feel like there's a triple consciousness, right? Like there's this other part of their identity that also doesn't get addressed and seen, right? But again, this idea of being a black person and living in a system of white supremacy, right, and always feeling like we got to do all of this extraness in order to show up, right? We got to put on these masks, we got to code switch, right? And we've done all of these things in order to survive, right? In order to protect our children, right? But the effects of that, right? How, you know, if we are truly free, right? What else do we need to be free from?
That black people can let it go. But when Will Smith slapped Chris Rock,
Pittsburgh that, you know, we're building a community of practice, right? And every single day is practice. So having these Sankofa circles, right, is a part of the work. And then when we get out and say, okay, we got to make a decision about how we're going to make this chocolate because we have a goal of making 50 bars, right? And we know that as we're practicing these things, right, the actual work that needs to be done is evidence of whether or not we did this other work, right? And so then we got to, okay, well, we only made 40. Well, what happened? Well, Johnny fell asleep on the job. You know what I'm saying? Because now, you know, then there's group accountability. Yeah. Well, Johnny, what can we do to support you going to bed earlier? Because we, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And so all of it, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like we're going to keep doing these circles, and we take these circles and we take what we've learned and how we best, right? Because what also happens in the circle, right, inside of the personal part, T, I'm coming, is that we get to know each other better. Right, so then I'm like, okay, now I understand why Asada shows up that way, mm-hmm. right? Like now I'm not making judgments about how she shows up, mm-hmm. because now I've been in five circles with her, and she shared some things on the individual level, mm-hmm. that helps me have more grace for her individually, right? But then also collectively, as we move into from the self in. Into how does this impact all of us, right? Then I get to say, because even when yesterday in the youth panel, right, I had to think like, dang, because I thought about this, but when the young sister talked about unstable homes and parents who, you know what I mean, I was like, oh, snap. Like, because that's what partly brought me to this work, is that I was in a household with my black parents, and it was a bunch of dysfunction in non-communication. I never, like, I didn't know how to use my voice. We didn't talk about nothing. I just, you know, I was not even prepared. I didn't feel like home was home. I didn't feel connected, right? And I think that me trying to figure that out is what led me to trying to find a village. Had me open, and then God was like, boom, here's this person, right? And so I think that there's you know, there's work on both sides, and you know, we're gonna get to that SCRR more in this piece, but it's a process, right? But it's a constant cycle. It's a constant cycle of looking at all of the ways in which we've internalized these things, right? And then as we do work, we recognize, like, okay, I thought you know, because sometimes you feel like you're healed from something, but then something hits you from another angle, and you're like, oh, snap, right? But healing is a lifelong journey, right? Like, we're learning every day how to better navigate, right, and how to not experience the anxiousness, learning how to breathe, right? I'm learning how to breathe every single day. Tia, we get to you.
Yeah.
Tia, first of all, I want to, yes, thank you for you and for your voice. Yes, thank you. You know, we're on the slide. And this is, you know, this is real. And we know how real it is. We live this every day. So this is what I'm going to ask the group, right? Because the power is in the people. So I'm going to ask the group here, the people of African descent, what is the collective comfort level, right? Because obviously these are conversations that we need to have. What is the comfort level? And this is, so I'm asking you, and then I'm also asking folks who do not identify as a person of African descent, right? Whatever the group says, that you would be willing to go with what the group says, right? So I'm a... There's grief.
So glad that this
well, hold on. Tyra had her hand up. Yeah, and let me just speak for myself, right? So when I asked the question, I want to let the group decide. That really was the question, is how does the group feel, right? So so she got up and she moved across the room, right? Which was her decision without me saying it, right? It was going to be a question of what would we like to see happen, right? Because it's not about you personally, right? It's about just whiteness, right? And the historical and present harm that whiteness brings, right? And we don't, you know, I don't know you from a can of paint. So I don't know what your intentions are. I don't know what your history is. I don't know how much you've done around your internalized racial superiority, right? I have no idea. However, if for the benefit of the collective of this work, right, anybody who does not identify as a person of African descent, right? If you care about the healing of Black people and us getting into our cooperative work, if you're not a person of African descent, then I would ask that you just politely leave the room. So that folks can feel safe enough to have the conversations, right? Because oftentimes, even when we say safe space, a space isn't necessarily safe just because, right, like, because it's all Black people,
exactly.
Right? But what it means and what we have to be intentional about is it being courageous space, right? And so even us being able to say, Tia, it was very courageous of you to use your voice and speak your mind in this moment. And it's also very courageous of us to say, we'd like people of African descent to remain in the room. And if that's not your heritage or shared history, then please allow us to continue the meeting without your presence.
And I differed with Keisha openly, as you saw.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted another choice, because I have a choice of how I will react in a moment. And I want to be clear. Part of white supremacy has been hijacked by Trump, right? And so for me, white people can leave, white people can stay, they can be invisible, I can erase them, I have choices. I just wanted to offer another choice, because there will be some times when you can't eliminate them. And I just want to say this is really important to me.
the individual. When you, what can you do within yourself to bring safety and security with your people holding you physically or metaphorically?
Right. And, but, right. Okay. So can the people who are not of African descent please leave the room? Is that okay? Is that okay with everybody in the group? Is there consensus that that's what we would like to do so that we can continue this conversation? Well, I do want to be clear about the intention of this space, because the intention of this space is not to ask white people what they feel about us having a Sankofa circle. So her role or anybody else's role in the space who's not a black person would have just been as an observer, period, number one. Right. First of all, I go.
Amen.
What we're gonna do, right? Because black folk, we, one of the things you said yesterday, right, is that we can be agreeable without having to agree on every point, right?
Yep.
And so, right now, we're gonna Well, this is the thing. So I'm going to just...
So with that said, you know, given, you know, 3 o'clock now...
Okay. But listen...
I'm on the other hand of this conversation. But I think...
We're not done. Right. So let me.
In a one essential way, and that's why LaKeisha offered hers, I offered another. Because again, it's not about one way, and we can still choose and come to a consensus. It's throwing those different views into the
I think that at this point, she's willing to leave the room. Let's just let it happen, and then we're going to keep on talking. Thank you. Okay. Well, I mean, if you are a person of African descent, you can stay in the room because it's your choice. Yeah. No, it's real. It's real. It's real. And for the fact that, right, like, we don't all know each other. So us coming into this space together and being able to have some courageous conversations about even how to come up with a consensus to handle a real when the shit jumps off, how are we going to deal with it? And it jumped off, right, and folks shared their feelings, shared their thoughts, right? Again, like, we're not a monolith. But why we have to have these consistent circles so that we can understand, right? Like, okay, now I know. Me and Tia have known each other for a long time. She was our original boutique manager at Ujamaa. She went and started working corporate. And then one day we haven't even talked to each other for a long time. Me and Sister Frankie went to her house and she was like, yo, listen, and I was like, sister, I need you at Ujamaa. And she was like, I'll be there tomorrow. When can I start? What? And I'm recognizing more in this moment all of what you're carrying. The residual effect of those environments you've been in. Like, I just did not, like, I knew it, but I didn't know it. Right? And so now, like, everything you told me, the little bits and pieces, all
Because we are going, when we have this reception, we're going to have some music, and we're going to be all in the other part of our cultural tools of dancing and, you know, cipher circles and all of that. I'm looking forward to that part of the culture. Okay. All right, this sister with the pink hat, she had her hand up for a minute.
Yeah, so, initial devotion.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it was getting a little steamy up in here. That's what people are raising,
right,
is about the whole conference,
yeah,
even though,
right. So, I mean, so that conversation, I mean, it's just like, because I think there are plenty of people like you who felt that coming to the whole conference, it was going to be wrong with a bunch of black folks.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that it's completely appropriate for people to be able to have that expectation. Like, it doesn't, like, every place doesn't have to be a place where you practice dealing with whiteness.
And God,
where are the places that we go to where we
we do have a decision-making conversation tomorrow. So that will be part three of this ongoing planned and spiritual movement. The right. 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 But that's you.
That's me,
but
right?
That's you.
And so now I know to say, if you're white in this majority space, don't take notes, because people will interpret it. And I know Natalie. I will say that I know Natalie. I know Natalie. Natalie reached out to me, and Natalie is the reason I wanted. She's the reason we had the young people, because I was fishing and boom, boom, and Natalie was like, I know this brother Ian. I'm going to set y'all up. Boom, boom, boom. I'm out of it. It's for y'all to do. And then when he didn't respond, she was like, did he respond? I was like, no. She like, let me nudge him. And he responded, right? So I'm just saying, I know Natalie, and I didn't feel
she played her
rescue
out.
Her. I could have rescued Natalie, but that waits for me to do, right? You know, but I'm just saying, I'm learning, and I want everybody to realize we come from such a diaspora.
Yeah.
We have so many different skills and abilities. And so now we know as facilitators, the next time we do this, then we should have some housekeeping around this, because I know that these sensitivities exist.
Mm-hmm. And I'm just going to take two more comments, and then we are going to go on with these slides, if that's okay with everybody. So that, because I know that the housekeeping of the building we're in is folks need to come and get their equipment and do all of this other stuff. Okay, Kane, Carlos, okay. Okay, yes, you did. Thank you, Brother Kane. Thank you. Thank you. Give it up to the ancestors. Yes. Yes.
You part of the coordinating team. You know you get the notes.
I know. Again, I gotta go and I'm like a phenomenon.
Right. All right. Okay.
And then I want to say an apology. We should have had a discussion when Ron announced that he was gonna bring white people. We should have. I didn't have no issue, right? But the people who had an issue, right, as a coordinating team, we should have had an open conversation about it. And that's on us. And I take responsibility, because we should have said, well, how people gonna feel and blah blah blah. Remember, it wasn't in my consciousness because of how I. We went to shoot.
Yes, it's a lesson learned.
So now we know. Moving forward, we'll take this into consideration. See, we can make mistakes, and I feel like we're relevant to the end.
Right. Mm-hmm.
because it was that internalized racial inferiority that's on the slide. And even when white folks are not around, right, we bring it to ourselves. I'm like, okay, we'll unpack that later, because I'm like, what happened? And maybe that, you know, and we can talk about it. Yeah, we can talk about it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And that, you know, we all have hurt people, right? Because hurt people, right? And I don't know if the sister and the brother are still here or not here, right? And if there is space for, right, and only you can decide, if there's space for grace and healing and accountability, right? Because accountability is love, right? So it's up to you to decide, right? And then folks can help to hold that space mm-hmm. for you. You're done with it. Okay. People's lessons come in the way that they come, and sometimes the conversation ain't even necessary. Mm-hmm. Give it to God, and
mm-hmm. and so I do want to say that the value of this moment is that conflicts have to be negotiated and navigated within the work that you're doing, right? Because these moments will come up, right? Because you have people who come from all walks of life. And, you know, even I saw the sister who got up as soon as we called the question, she left. Right, and I'm noting it in my mind because for her, that's a question that's unconscionable, right? It may be rude, it may be whatever, right? And so again, it's important that we remember that we have to figure out, if you're gonna work with black people around cooperatives, you've got to work around all of this. And it doesn't mean that you have all the resources within you. Maybe you need someone that deals with grief, right? Or that deals with trauma, right? That can hold sessions within your group, right? As things come up, you have to be prepared. But what I do believe is that the power of community, right? Like bell hooks, so this idea, that's another thing about the kind of like individual. People don't like to say, you know, I got trauma or I got triggered, because it's really part of the white supremacy paradigm around mental health and all these pieces, right? And bell hooks introduce a different model. So that's to your point about we don't work on our trauma and then do our work. Bell hooks say that we do our work as we're working on our trauma, right? And it's in the work that the healing happens, right? So rather if ever any of us healed in isolation, healing is an act of communion, right? It's also difficult because, see, in isolation, we're perfect. All is well. That's why I'm fool with people. That's why I roll by myself, because people be tripping, and I don't even do all that. That's why I don't have no friends. I don't hang out. I don't like no women, boom, boom, boom. Because you, in isolation, you're perfect. But in relationship, people bump up against your scars, right? Your wounds, right? You know, as my spiritual teacher say, people pushing your buttons, but they didn't install it. Right, Nella didn't install that button. She just pushed it because she happened to be white, right? And so also understanding how to get to that rewiring within ourselves is also work. It's the importance of being in community, how therapeutic our communities can be. And cooperatives, to me, are communities. They're communities, right? When I'm building a cooperative, I'm building a community where people have shared value, shared relationship. They can depend on one another, right? They're going to go through some ups and downs together, but there's a level of commitment there, right? We're in this thing, right? Racism and patriarchy deplete and exhaust, right? So we got to plug back into our community so that we can be restored, right? I'm always tired and overwhelmed, and then I got an 8:00 construction cooperative meeting on a Monday night, but when I leave, I'll be like, oh, yeah, we're going to take on the world tomorrow. Right, because I get renewed by being in community. So I don't see my cooperative as a depletion, but if you're not leaving the cooperative meeting feeling renewed, Right, and you gotta do some practices, you gotta do some check-ins. You know, you got to leave. I play Toby at every meeting, you know, then I play Sweet Honey in the Rock. We are the ones, we are the ones, we are the ones. You know, it's part of creating that sense of renewal, right? So being able to commune with others who share our similar same experiences can provide a restorative outlet for racialized people. So cooperatives are a healing, powerful transformation tool. It's not something separate and aside. We do healing over here, and then we do cooperative businesses over here. They have the ability to do both, and we think if you add the Sankofa model to it, it happens.
Can I say one thing real quick? So last weekend, back in Pittsburgh, our group partnered with another group, and we had an Africana wellness conference, right? And one of the sisters who was presenting at the conference, Dr. Tahira Walker, she was specifically talking about how in our DNA, right, at the bottom of our DNA strands are these things called telomeres, and that because of trauma, and specifically racialized trauma, right, our telomeres, which are responsible for us passing on our legacy, right, our telomeres get shorter and shorter and shorter because of the trauma, right? And then scientists have proven that when you're in community, when you're around your people, when you're sharing values, right, and being communal, right, and being cooperative with your folks, your telomeres will repair and grow themselves longer, right? So I just wanted to share that because, you know, this is spiritual work. There's physical things happening in our bodies, right? There's so much on every level of our being that this work can restore.
And so, you know, we don't, many times, and I don't think this group will see this kind of work of the Sankofa circle and the work of healing as like this fuzziness, right? But it's really, you know, really concrete things that, yeah, I know y'all say that white people be, but that I be peeping out with white people, right? You know, I be like, oh, okay, that's that social capital. I'm going to use that in the corporate businesses. That's it right there, right? Because I need to be able to express this in a way that makes sense. So sociologists have studied this thing, right? They study what is the power of the group, right? And so remember the Sankofa circle, it's the building of the group. We're building up community. It's a tangible way. White people and cooperatives are trying to figure out how to build this collective identity, right? I'm telling you, like, they have so many questions about what, you know, the corporate identity is in crisis. People don't feel it, and they're losing cooperatives, right? So the idea of being able to say, what is our vehicle for building community? It doesn't just happen because you have a corporate business. It just doesn't happen because you have a co-op. You have to be very explicit in creating the pathways, the practices that build community, right? And it's this social capital, right, which are tangible things. So the question is about, do we have relationships here, right? If people don't fool with each other, they're not relating with each other, they're not doing things outside of working together, they're not going to each other's baby showers or birthday gatherings. Really, seriously, that means that their only relationship is around the economics, and that's not enough, right? So it's around those ties. And then the sister said, Pastor Jones, trust is a big thing about trust, right? And we know people of African descent have a high issues with trust. I'm like, the sister said the thing because we got a brother, and he'll be there like all the time. Well, it ain't white people that did mess me up. It's black people. Jabari be on it. It's them black people that did me wrong, talked about me when I was in school, beat me up, bullied me. Aside, I'm telling you, it's the black people, right? And so many of us come into community with each other with lots of trust issues, right? And so the Sankofa circle lets us build trust. Right? Jabari came into that circle, we dealt with him, all the issues, all whatever, boom, 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 boom. We were consistent. We held the space, right? And so Sankofa's let you build trust. I can say that thing. I can insult somebody or they can get hurt and they're gonna still welcome me back the next week, right? Right? It's about that trust. It's about letting people know we steady, right? Like I can disagree with Keisha. We still gonna be sisters, and ain't gonna, you know what I mean? Right. We still gonna be sisters. It's about that trust, and particularly around conflict, because most people believe, you know, when you grow up, if it's conflict, somebody gonna get hurt, right? Something bad is gonna happen, and even if there's conflict, then I'm gonna lose my relationship with that person, right? It's important for people to see us in conflict and be able to still come back to a center place with each other. masturbator to go through that and still be okay, and the Sankofa circle allows that. And then it allows for tangible resources, right? When Jabari's house burned down, we was able to, when I moved to Pittsburgh, Keisha found the apartment. I ain't never even seen the apartment. She went out and found it and said, that's where y'all gonna live, right? So we were sharing resources, right? So again, the Sankofa circles give our cooperatives these valuable things. That's why when the money doesn't come, right, people still hang on. For 3 years, we've been building a cooperative, and nobody got paid. None of the founders. We hired somebody. That's the only person who got paid. But it's because of this stuff. When someone's mother died, we were there for her, right? She was able to show. It's about this stuff that will allow people to come back. And the Sankofa circles are just a small way in which you can do that. I'm sorry, my slide. So shared values, interpersonal relationship, social trust, reciprocity, cooperation and collaboration, shared understanding, shared sense of identity, strong social support. The Sankofa circles that we've been practicing allowed us to create that. And so it's been an extension of our work to build Black cooperatives. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So this is, Ujamaa Collective. We've been through some things. And, when I was, this is probably like 2014, 15, when I came across this quote by Dr. Amos Wilson. And because, I got on fire about co-ops when I was working at the East End Food Co-op. It was like, because I already was doing a lot of stuff in Black spaces in Pittsburgh, as an activist. But I was like, dang, like if only we knew about this, we could solve all of these problems, right? But all this other stuff comes up, right? And so, right, and he hit the nail on the head. Like when we want to do something economically together, and most people actually, a lot of people that I've talked to will always say that, right, like when we're looking at, poverty and all of these social issues that Black people are challenged with, right, like a lot of times we will, right, in a lot of these white institutions, even if they're led by Black people, right, we'll throw money at it. We will, try to do all of these different things, but the cultural piece is missing, right? Or people will have a cultural piece, but won't have the economic piece, right? And so we have to be able to do both, right? But he talks about, right, when we get together, it's not always the absence of money in terms of why we fail, right? But it's because we are not taking the time, right? Because this could have been a whole debacle, right? And the reality is some people probably were feeling like this is about to turn into a thing, right? Like, I'm not sure who the sister was who got up and left, right? Or whoever left, or even the other sister who left afterwards, right? And she felt uncomfortable, right? One of the things that I've learned in this work, right, is that, and I do my best to, you talked about Kwanzaa and the seven principles, right? The Nguzo Saba. And Ujamaa is the fourth principle of Kwanzaa. It means cooperative economics, right? And all of these seven principles, right, were created and sort of reimagined as a way in which Black people could build their families, build, a community. But I think often about how we're triggered often in the work, and we'll leave the table before, right, because this is the work. Us having these conversations, this is the work, right? And we'll get triggered and be like, I'm never coming back, right? But if we would just, right, because it's not safe unless we practice courage with one another. It's not going to be a safe space. Like, it's not safe just because we say it is. Right? So we have to, some of us, until it's all of us, have to practice being courageous and showing up to say, okay, all right, Tia, Tia said what she needed to say. She needed to express that. How are we receiving that information, right? And then how can we hear each other and disagree with one another, but still out of that, right, come to a solution that's going to meet everybody's needs in the space as best as possible, right? And oftentimes we're not in a psychological space, right, and not open to it to be there, right? So we actually have a Sankofa facilitator manual that needs a little update because it was created in like 2007. So we do want to be able to share that at some point, but we do need to do some updates to it. But we've, the last year or so Asad and I, out of, yes, both of our groups, but out of Pittsburgh, we're doing what we call an African-centered cooperative research project, right? And, you know, and Asada had to remind me, because I was like, you know, black folks, especially in Pittsburgh, right, we're a city of eds and meds. So we got schools and hospitals, and we're getting researched on all day, every day, in every part of ourselves, physically, psychologically, right? And so when you know, Pitt or whoever else says we gonna come and do research, right, it's like, ooh, you know what I mean? And so I was like, you know, how are people gonna receive this, right? And then Asada reminded me, like, well, Keisha, well, research just means to create knowledge. And then I had to, like, put myself back in, like, ancient Kemet, right, and be like, this is who we are. We've always been creating knowledge. We've always been doing research for ourselves. Because if we weren't doing research and creating knowledge, we wouldn't be passing it on to our children, right? Like, we would not be participating in this cycle of life, right? And so a part of it is also reclaiming these things that, you know, get whitewashed, and then we think that it's not ours, but most of what's out here is actually our stuff, right? But so in the process of doing a Sankofa circle, right, you have a group of facilitators. So you're not going to do a Sankofa circle by yourself. That's number one. So you need at least another person, right, but at least three, right, depending on the size of the group. You need more than one, right? And
because we come from the diaspora, right? And we have
right.
many different experiences. And
right.
One
right. And so there's a, even before you have the circle, there's a planning meeting. And the planning meeting is like the pre-Sankofa, right? So myself, Asada, Brother Ron, Brother Omar, and Jules, right, and actually Brother Mabry was it on the first one. We met a good 3-4 times to develop some of the questions for the Sankofa circle we did this morning, right? And like even in those meetings, right, I did a libation, and we talked about what it means to set a cultural tone, right? Because that's super important. Right, because we want black people, we want ourselves to show up and be present in that space, right, and to be able to put the mask down. And so when we come into the space with the group in the actual Sankofa, right, when we're getting down to business, right, so we're going to explain the symbol, we ask people to introduce themselves. We couldn't do that because we had 116 people in the room, right, this morning, right? But whatever the topic or theme of that circle is, right, in your planning session, you would have gone through that topic, right? You would have talked about it. You would have asked yourselves these questions first before you bring it to a larger group, right? So you would have kind of workshopped these things out. And so where are we at, right? So there's, we talk about all of the ways in which a Sankofa circle can operate and all of the ways in which it can impact people, right? We said it's a think tank, a discussion, a healing group, right? And that folks should feel free inside of the circle to share and speak their minds and disagree as long as there is overriding respect, right? So the circle is about us being able to say, I don't see it that same way. Well, as much as you can. As much as you can.
You want to resolve it in a smaller group before you bring it to the bigger group? Yeah, and we resolve it because we don't leave with big schisms, right? I mean, part of the process, like a carpet is working together and being heard, like, well, you know, there's Jules in here.
Facebook. She's in Texas. You're in D.C., uh-huh. right? And Ron was like, well, you know, how are we going to do this with 100 people, mm-hmm. right? And I said, Ron, like, you have to trust that mm-hmm. black folks are going to show up for themselves, mm-hmm. right? And he asked some other question, and I had to say, well, you know what? Like, it's going to work because, you know, we've had this experience multiple times, right? And not to say that we're the experts, but we've just had some experiences that have demonstrated for us what we're capable of together, right? And I think a part of it is because, like, and I didn't know, you know what I'm saying? I've known Ron now for 6 years or so, right? But I didn't recognize that NDCC was only 7 years old, right? And I asked Ron yesterday, well, what were you doing before that, right? And he was in a nonprofit space, but I think that, right, like we have these different experiences, mm-hmm. and now, right, as we develop our consciousness, we're all here. But we're bringing this stuff, right? And sometimes our practices and our processes need to shift and change for us to get the maximum benefit for everybody out of
like
it, right?
Just I keep like bringing it back to
right.
the cooperative, right? Because we're practicing and we're bringing y'all together as a cooperative, and part of what a cooperative requires is trust.
Right.
And so Ron had to realize, I'm trying to be cooperatively with these sisters. I'm going to have to extend them some trust.
Yes.
Right. So that's, you. Again, you're just trying to practice the values that you need to make this thing work.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not practicing it, how can it be present in your co-op?
Mm-hmm.
You got to practice it, and that's the hard work.
This slide before? She's also very emotional. That's
yeah.
the other side,
so
right?
I'm
right. And
yeah.
and let me say this: the other part of the overzealousness, right? And this happens often, and especially with younger people, especially
yeah.
with younger people. And this happened a lot when we were in college. Is that right? Like because we don't spend enough time studying our condition, right? That like once we learn something, right? We you know we're like okay, self questions, collective root, and we get to responsibility. Folks are like I'm ready to move out.
Right.
I'm ready to do this. Right? We're like hold on, because actually it's not yet a shared understanding.
Right.
Because you gonna move out and there gonna be two people, but the other 20 people are still over here trying to figure out what you moving out on. Right? Because we haven't had enough time
yeah.
together.
Right.
right? And so that's kind of what I mean when I say that, right? Is that like some people are ready to move, but the group ain't ready to move.
And you don't have a cooperative if you don't have five people. I keep bringing back to the cooperative.
Right.
right
the basics.
So
that's the basics.
Two, you ain't got a cooperative. You need to keep talking. You need to keep building. Connecting,
right.
right? So you got the commitment and my state. And then you got the commitment of five people. You don't
right.
have a cooperative business, right?
Mm-hmm.
I know we move in fast and it's late and things, but that's a little bit what I was referring
because everybody has to be able to see the whole picture and not just the part, right, Jules? Younger doing it, when we would make our flyers, so whatever the topic was, we would, you know, we would, you know, we were causing controversy because we know that the drama is what brings black people to the yard. Right. And so, you know, I remember one time we were having an identity conversation and we said, it was like nigga, funny because the brother who now actually runs the black school that my daughter goes to, he was a student at Pitt at the time. And I had already, you know, I was already out of school, right, but was going on campus to do this work. And he pulled me and Asada into, it was the, it's the Pitt's black, what's it called? The Black Action Society. And they all pulled us to a meeting with their board members and tried to accuse us of like embarrassing them because it wasn't professional. And it, you know what I mean? All of this sort of black excellence that we were not displaying, right? And we had to let them know that like we're meeting people where they're at, right? So I would just encourage you to, right, choose topics that obviously get you to where you want to go, but choose topics that you know are going to get people there, right? Like with the Black Worker Center, sometimes they don't even be making flyers and stuff, and I'm like, what are y'all doing? I'm on the board, right? Like, we have to speak the language of the people we're trying to reach, right? Because we know we need these single black women who are working in these hospitals, cleaning rooms and working in, you know, food service and whatnot. Like, this is who needs to be building co-ops, in Pittsburgh. But if we can't get them to the meeting to have these Sankofa circles, right, we're never going to get there, right? That internalized racism.
Right, mm-hmm. Because black people have been blamed all the time. And the proper social analysis, because it's white supremacy each and every day, is just manifesting itself in different ways, right? It's patriarchy. It's at the system level, right? Because otherwise, we won't, and that's why we're bringing you here, because we want you to also know that you can't just build a co-op in your local area and we're going to be free. That ain't going to happen, right? And you ain't going to co-op your way to liberation. We've got to amp up our work, and that's why we've got to think about the root, because this thing operates on the system level. And that's where you bring your resources, you can bring in somebody from a university, you can bring in people. You have learned people, right? That's when you can bring in guests, talk about this issue, break this issue down. We use videos. That is very helpful, right? We use podcasts. You always want to bring something. We used to bring articles from books.
We used to read stuff. Because, and because oftentimes what happens is that if you're having consistent circles, right, and you don't bring in resources from Dr. Joy DeGry or other people, right, people be like, oh, that's just what Keisha's talking about. Like, no, actually, it's not just what I'm talking about. It's what has been researched. It's what these other black people in other places are talking about, right? Like, and sometimes your resources can also be the thing that sparks the conversation at the very beginning. It could be a clip from a movie.
Omar's clip, you know, that was...
Yeah, I mean, but it doesn't even have to be like a true and living thing, right? Mm-hmm. Like, so if we were gonna talk about the role of black masculinity, right? If we were gonna do that we would do one of my favorite movies, Robert Townsend. Oh, what was that movie called? No. It was a Hollywood Shuffle. Oh, I love that movie, right? Oh, I love that movie. manufactured black people's identities in so many ways, right? But yeah, like you can bring, you know, you can be really creative with your resources, right? Whatever's gonna get people from one place to the next and kind of spark that thought and kind of get people talking, that's what you wanna bring. You know what I mean? And then of course, inside of Root, it's always nice to have something that is outside of just us saying, ooh, I've internalized this and so have you, and folks be all defensive and stuff, right? But to consistently bring something in that Root section of questions that helps to center us in that historical piece. So when we get to, you know, closing this circle, and today was a good example, right? Be comfortable enough together to be uncomfortable and to keep coming back, right? And we've been in many spaces, right? Because black people are rejected in so many spaces with each other, with each other, right? And we've had that, I'm sure we all have had that experience, right? I think, I don't know if it was you, Tyra, talking on the panel yesterday or if it was the younger sister next to you, right? But a lot of times we're like, we don't always feel connected to other black people, mm-hmm. right? And we have to create a circle for every black body, mm-hmm. right? For every black body. And be accountable inside of the circle that if somebody feels like they were unwelcome for whatever, whether it was real or whether it was their own perception of what, you know what I mean? Because sometimes we also have to be responsible for our own triggers and our own stuff, right? So, but oftentimes the Sankofa circle is the space where black people, you know, many black people for the first time feel connected, feel in community, feel a level of affirmation, feel seen, right? And that I think is like the power of the circle, right? Is that everybody is together. Right, and there's nothing about you, right? There's nothing about you that wouldn't have you be included, right? Unless you up in here wielding knives and guns at other black people, right? Then we might have to put you out, right? but we know it's probably because of the root causes, you know what I'm saying, that got you acting a fool. But we're going to analyze you back into yourself. Right, right. But, you know, this morning we used the call and response by Brother Gil Scott Heron, and we edited that version, right, to say, because the original version just says sisters and brothers, right, and we said sisters, brothers, and siblings, because we wanted to acknowledge that gender is a construct, right, and that everybody needs to feel included, right, and that also is, right, like, there's space for this circle to grow with who was in the circle. How we did Sankofas 20 years ago, right, some things have remained the same, some things don't change, but we've grown, right, like, who I was at 20, the things I knew, you know what I mean? I didn't even have a good understanding of patriarchy and sexism, right? And as a young person and with some of the brothers who are in our group, they also didn't understand, right? So there was a lot of sexist dynamics happening constantly, right? And there was one sister, Sister Nyla from Philadelphia, and I had to recently, right, in us doing, you know, coming back together and doing work, I had to say to her, sister, I apologize to you. I didn't know what I didn't know 20 years ago. And she was standing alone and calling out patriarchy and sexism. And I just didn't know enough. I just didn't fully see myself at that time, right? As powerful as I felt, I just wasn't there yet, right? But 20 years later, I'm like, sister, you was holding it. But she had trauma from holding it alone. And I had to acknowledge that because the trauma still was unresolved, right? Like, she's done some work, but she'll still get triggered when she shows up with the whole group, right? And then we have to learn and build in new practices. So technically at the end of every session, we'll do some kind of reflection, right? So when we were in person, we would just pass out little quarter sheets of paper, and how do you feel? What are your thoughts, right? You can ask very specific questions. Like in Zoom, they have like a virtual poll, but it's very yes or no, right? It's not like people can be, you know, writing, you know, words and like essay sort of like open-ended stuff. So Zoom polls are like the built-in Zoom poll is very limited in that regard, right? So we were asking yes or no questions in our virtual poll with the Black Workers Center. However, right, you know, you have a shared screen in Zoom and you have the chat, right? So if you're doing a virtual Sankofa, you can also, right, use links and tell people, okay, go to this page and use another resource to do the data piece, right? And then you can ask whatever questions you want to ask. But most importantly, it's like a temperature, like a feeling check-in, like how are you feeling, right? And that's how we then knew, right? Like, oh, people feel spiritually renewed in the space. People feel like they learned something new, right? And so us doing the word cloud, right? Like Brother Omar suggested that, right? And it was like, oh yeah, that would be dope to use a word cloud, especially because there's so many people, right? Like, we didn't really have the capacity to pass out quarter sheets to everybody in the space, right? And we were obviously pressed on time and trying to keep this conference to the time factor that it's in. But yeah, I think that there's, you know, there's room, you know, there's the model and there's things that we know have worked, but this is like open source, right? Which is why we're sharing it, right? In the sense that, like, there's many of us who have been doing the work of holding spaces for Black people, right? Who've been doing the work of facilitating Black people in a multitude of ways, right? And so we're just saying to those people who've been doing that and people who want to do that, here's another model that you can use to get this particular kind of process moving for people, right? But this isn't the only way, right? And you can take this and make it your own. So, you know, we strongly believe in following the SDRR framework, right? But how you open up and set that tone, right? Whether you want to do a libation, whether you want to do
music,
a prayer, reading, right? Whatever those cultural tools are, you can make them your own, right? When we started doing work for the Black Worker Center, right? One of the leaders of the Black Worker Center was like, you know, I'm not particularly spiritual, right? And I was like, well, you know, I can use different language, right? Like I feel like a part of my purpose is like being able to speak language to speak to all Black people, no matter if you're Christian, you're Muslim, or you're agnostic, or you're whatever, right? Because it's really in the culture. So sometimes we can come into the space and do a multitude of things, but we want people to be centered and present. And we want to acknowledge that we are continuing a practice of Black people, right? We didn't just start this, right? That there's ancestors who've been doing this work. We wouldn't even be